Good morning, welcome to St. Mark's. We're giving Pastor Perry a break to Sundays, so I'm happy to be here and welcome you in the name of the congregation. St. Mark's is a welcoming community devoted to serving and sharing Christ's love and saving grace, which means that you are welcome no matter where you're at in life's journey. In opening chapter number 8:3.
Oh, dug it and cleared those stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine bath in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you that I will do what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste, it shall not be pruned or mowed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his blessed planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death. If I somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sunlight, water.
Too much to drain out.
And what about weeds?
So we can get a bad example.
gardener than me.
Yes.
What about weeds? We have to take weeds out? Pull the weeds out. Okay, so there's a story about a man who grows a garden and he plants the garden and up comes lots of plants and he takes good care of it. And he takes all the weeds out and the plants are growing and they're grape vines, they're grapes. And so he expects that they're going to be grapes when he comes back. So he goes on a long trip and he comes back. And what happens? There weren't any good grapes. They were all bad grapes, right? So he wasn't. What was he not doing? What? He was not taking good care of them. Like they weren't doing all the things you need to do. The things that you said, right? So. Let's say that the garden is God's creation. The whole world is God's garden. Then God takes care of it, right? Through the rain and the sunshine, but what about us?
We have to take care of it too, because yes. God is an evil word.
So she said, you have to take care of it because it's God's creation and we honor God, right? So we have to take care of the garden. I need to put you up here in the pulpit and opening the sermon. This is fantastic. Great. Okay, so we work with God to take care of God's creation, right? Who takes care of you? Your mom and dad, right? Okay. And in the same way, God takes care of us, and God takes care of our creation. Yes?
We have to take care of our plants and feed them with water. And if not, we don't get any sun or water.
Right, we have to plant the plant. We have to water the plants, right? And make sure that they get in the sun. Thank you. Yeah, well, thank you for your help this morning. Grace and peace is ours in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Miami is a city of newcomers, immigrants, snowbirds, tourists. In Miami, we celebrate diversity. Historically, Miami has not only welcomed immigrants, but the city thrives because of newcomers. We do not see diversity as a threat. We see it as an asset. St. Paul wrote his letter to the Philippians. That was the second lesson this morning. He wrote it to the Philippians at a time when they were experiencing a culture clash between the traditional religious faithful and the newcomers. Philippi was a Greek city in Macedonia. Macedonia a little bit further north from Greece, right? So there were Greeks and Jews and Christians all mixed in one community, and they had problems. They had divided into two groups, the insiders and the outsiders, the righteous and the not so righteous. Insiders believe that the problem was that the newcomers refused to conform to the traditional religious customs. The outsiders saw the situation differently. They felt unworthy and unwelcome. If you were of the mind that new Christians had to obey all the laws of Moses, then of course you would require new converts to eat kosher and to observe the rituals and the customs of Moses. But if you believe that the laws of Moses were not applicable to new converts to Christ, then you would not require things like circumcision or eating kosher or the rituals of purity and so on. So the church in Philippi was divided, and both sides blamed the other side. The insiders claimed to be righteous and criticized the new converts for their disregard of the religious rules. So St. Paul begins his argument saying, if anyone has reason to brag about their righteousness, I have more. And then he lists his religious credentials. He was born a Jew, circumcised on the eighth day, grew up in a religious family, he obeyed the laws of Moses, he studied the scriptures and the law, he was a passionate follower of the law, and he was one of a group called the Pharisees, a sect known for strict obedience to the Jewish purity laws. Paul was so passionate that when the Christian movement emerged, he became a persecutor of Christians. Remember, back then he was called Saul. Paul's interpretation of Scripture justified his belief at that time that Christians were unrighteous and impure. So, fast forward, when Paul writes the letter to the Christian church in Philippi, he is no longer a Pharisee. He's no longer persecuting Christians because he now is a Christian and perhaps the most remarkable evangelist of the early church. Yet, when he writes this letter, he's in prison and he's suffering physically and emotionally. Paul now says that his religious resume is worthless. He counts all of this, all of his righteousness and purity credentials as not only without value, but they get in the way. They obstruct what is far more important. St. Paul is like the man who climbed the ladder of success, and when he got to the top, he realized that his ladder was set up against the wrong wall. All of his efforts to climb to the top were useless. All of his religious efforts to be righteous and ritually pure were of no value. When he finally realized that God forgave him and reconciled him, not because of his righteousness and religious purity, but by grace alone, then Paul realized that his former road to righteousness was futile. All of his efforts to be pure and righteous could not buy salvation. In fact, they got in the way. He had become so pure and righteous that he felt that he had earned his salvation on his own. And he looked down with scorn on all those that he judged as unworthy. Before he knew Christ, he felt that he had already earned his ticket to heaven. At that time, he didn't understand that there's nothing a human can do to earn salvation. At that time, he didn't understand the significance of the crucifixion, death, and resurrection of Jesus. In fact, he had become the main persecutor of Christians. He was there when they stoned Stephen, a passionate evangelist for Christ. At that time, he had no understanding of what the Christians meant when they spoke of freedom in Christ. Paul passionately obeyed the laws of Moses, and he had no need for this freedom in Christ. He had no idea what the Christians were talking about until the day on the road to Damascus when he met the living Christ, the risen Christ. He was blinded by a bright light and heard the voice of Jesus say to him, "Why are you persecuting me?" On the day of his conversion, Paul knew in his heart that he had been wrong about Christ, wrong about the law, wrong about salvation, and wrong about righteousness. He knew that he deserved to die right then and there because of his violence against the believers in Christ, but what he experienced instead was not God's wrath and punishment, but forgiveness and grace. And that changed his life. It changed his entire worldview. My mother, some years ago when she was alive, she came home devastated from a church woman's meeting. At the meeting, they introduced themselves to a new woman who had just arrived in town. And each person gave their name and said where they were from. And my mom introduced herself and said that this was her hometown. But some women in the group corrected her, saying, "You're not from here. To be from here, you must be born here." Well, my mother had lived in that town and had attended the church for over 25 years. Two of her children had been baptized in that church. Four of her children had been confirmed at the church, and one of them, that would be me, was ordained there. She had volunteered in church activities for many years, and now some of the women were trying to make themselves exclusive by separating out those who were truly the insiders from the outsiders by saying, "You must be born in this town in order to be from here." And so after many years of feeling like she was a big part of the group, suddenly she felt like an outsider. I guess we don't have that problem in Miami because we're all from somewhere else. I can only imagine what it felt like to be a new convert in the church in Philippi. They were divided into two groups, the insiders and the outsiders. The insiders were the ones with the religious credentials. Born a Jew, circumcised, obedient to the kosher laws, strict observer to purity laws, while the outsiders had no such religious credentials. They had not submitted to the initiation rituals. They did not eat kosher. They disregarded the purity laws that required the faithful to disassociate with sinners and the unclean. The newcomers not only associated with and tolerated outcasts, and because they were unclean, the only credential they had was their faith in Jesus Christ. So Paul took the side of the outsiders in his argument here, even though he qualified more than anyone to claim a rightful place as an insider. Paul argued in his letter to the Philippians that now he counts all his gains of righteousness and righteous and purity living as a loss. He wrote, "More than that, I regard everything as lost because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and regard them as rubbish, in order that I might gain Christ and be found in him, and not having a righteousness of my own that comes Christ. He is, or Christ is, the righteousness from God. Based on faith, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, says Paul. So Paul came to understand his religious resume as worthless because it missed the most important thing, to know Jesus. He came to the conclusion that the more he focused his life on his own religious purity, the more he relied on himself and not on God. And therein is the danger of living the righteous life. Jesus observed this danger in the Pharisees. They were obsessed with religious purity and righteousness. Or was that just their public persona? The Pharisees were a very small minority in the Jewish nation, but they were powerful because they had made a bargain with the Roman authorities. The Roman governors, like Herod and Pontius Pilate, had a collaborative relationship with chief priests and Pharisees. The Pharisees had a vested interest in maintaining order and suppressing opposition. By opposing the Jesus movement, the Pharisees were doing the bidding of the Roman authorities. I suspect that they were hiding that relationship with the powerful Romans by flaunting their righteousness. The Pharisees criticized Jesus, saying he invited the unclean to table fellowship and he associated with sinners. The Pharisees' obsession with purity and righteousness, which may have been smoke and mirrors, put them on a path that opposed any suggestion that Jesus might be the Messiah. Jesus' life and ministry manifested all the signs and wonders associated with the scriptures that prophesy the Messiah. Yet the Pharisees chose not to see it. Jesus healed the sick, gave sight to the blind, fed the multitude, cast out demons, set the captives free, and even raised the dead. And all the Pharisees could do was criticize him for violating the purity laws. Were they worried about purity, or were they anxious that they would lose their privileges and power if the Jesus movement succeeded? I wonder if their obsession with maintaining the status quo prevented them from opening their hearts to the love and compassion of Jesus. We remember that Mary, sister of Lazarus, opened her heart to Jesus. She extravagantly anointed Jesus' feet with expensive perfume, ignoring the criticisms, because what she valued most was her friendship with Jesus. Now, it's not just about knowing Jesus in order to save your soul, to be united in death and resurrection. But more important than that for Paul, it was to know Jesus as a friend, a constant companion in this life. It seems to me that this is what Paul is talking about in getting to know Jesus now as a friend and not waiting until the end, at the last moment. You hear some people say, I'll live my life like I want to, and in the end, at the last moment, I'll confess my sins, and God will forgive me, and so I'll get into heaven anyway. But they're missing the precious friendship that they could have had during their entire lifetime. It's not just about reconciliation and salvation. It's about coming to know Jesus as a friend and companion now, during this journey we call life. So Paul knew all about living the righteous life. He lived it to perfection. He had believed that God will reward you for your purity and your righteous living. And the righteous person puts his or her hope in his or her own perfection or good works. And St. Paul discovered the great irony that our own striving for religious purity actually gets in the way of our friendship with Jesus. Perhaps you've had a similar life experience as Paul. Perhaps like St. Paul, you came to realize how much God loves you even when you felt you were unlovable, and how God trusted you even at a time when you did not trust yourself, and how God forgave you even when you could not forgive yourself. To come to know that kind of friendship is better than to achieve religious purity. It's not the experience of attaining religious righteousness, but the experience of God's loving embrace that now transforms us. What a friend we have in Jesus. A friendship with Jesus offers us a companion who truly understands us. Jesus becomes the friend who comes in when everyone else leaves. When we are lonely, Jesus is with us. When we are weak, Jesus is our strength. When we are broken, Jesus heals. When we feel inner chaos, Jesus gives us peace. In Jesus, we come to know divine friendship. He assures us, saying, "I will be with you until the end of the age." And that, my friends, is good news for the world.
trusting in the transformative power of God's loving spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of all grace, you are the source of life and joy. Strengthen the resolve of your church throughout the world, that together we press on toward the goal of your heavenly call in Jesus Christ. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of creation, you plant and nourish the earth as your own precious vineyard. Bless fields and orchards and the hands of those who labor in them, that your people are fed with an abundant harvest of good fruit. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of all the earth, you desire peace and justice between nations and peoples. Guide leaders of nations, states, provinces, and cities, that they faithfully govern your people with wisdom, integrity, and compassion. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of all compassion, in Christ, you lovingly pour yourself out like wine for your people. Have mercy on all the mourn who struggle with their mental health, who cry out for justice, who hunger and all in any need. Especially we pray for Bobbin, Dobby, Werner, Juan Luis, Viviana and Gerardo, Alyssa, Don and Barbara, Earl, Yvonne, Inesin, Margaret, Nicholas, Nina, Nora, Suraj, Alicia, Eileen, and Bradley, Sharon, Timmy, Nestor, Eunice, Greg, Angeles, Diane, Natalie, Kimberly. We also have special prayers today for Christine Garcacha, for Lori Nash. We also have special prayers for the family of Parnell Lee as they mourn his passing. We also have a very special prayer today for the people of Israel, and we pray for peace in the Middle East. God of grace,
hear our prayers.
God of all steadfastness, you set Christ as the cornerstone and foundation of the church. Build up this congregation as living stones, that it stands in the community as a witness to your enduring faithfulness and love. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of all hope, the saints who came before us lived and died with their hearts fixed on you. We give you thanks for their faithful witness, and we wait with hope for the great day when we join you with their voices in praise. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and amazing grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Thank you. I
Let us pray. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, gave himself to take away our sin, for in dying has destroyed death, and rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, and earth and sea and all their creatures, and angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join our unending hymn.
Yeah.
Strengthened by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
If you could all be seated for just one moment, before the benediction, I'll do a couple of the announcements. Coming up Friday on the 13th of October, the Florida Guitar Foundation, they'll be having an open mic concert here at St. Mark's. Everyone is welcome. If you play the guitar, anyone is welcome, right?
Yes.
So if you play the guitar, or you just want to listen and be a part of it, please join us on the 13th. It should be a really great event. We're actually very excited about a lot of these upcoming things here at St. Mark's. Our church council meeting will not be on the 17th. It will be the following Tuesday, the 23rd, right? The 23rd.
24th.
Yeah, I put up the wrong video. Following Tuesday, the 24th. So, if we find the 17th, it will be the 24th. Our chocolate retreat. This is a great event. We've been doing this for a couple of years now. This is like our fourth year. Or fifth year. It's the fifth year. Wow. Please join us at this event. This will be on Saturday, October the 28th, from 4 to 6 p.m. If you're able to volunteer, please contact Josie. The more cars we have out there with some cute little trunks, the nicer it is. This has become a really great event every February, October. So if you're not doing a park, then at least come and join us and support us and enjoy the little kitties running around and having fun and have some family too. And then on October 29th, Bonanza Lyric Opera. We can join us. This is going to be night of Broadway and opera hits presented by Bonanza Lyric Opera. This will be at 7 p.m. here at St. Mark's. The cost is $15. So miss is the factor concert. This is going to be really fun to have here. And then on November 11th, we're going to have our very old choir put on concert for us. So it'll be night of the movies, and this will be music for movies.
From movies.
How exciting about that. So the cost of that is $10, and that is to support our choir ministry, so that's a donation. You will enjoy some music and some live refreshments and market calendars for November 11th. It'll be a great event. And if you have any needs, please talk to Pastor Perry, and his phone number is here. Thank you, Pastor, for letting us come to this.
Pastor, I have one more announcement.
Okay. All right.
After the service, if you are able-bodied and willing, we need to move that altar off of the platform in order to prepare for Friday night's concert. So it's maybe 5, 6, 7 of us can come back in after the service ends to help move that. We would so much appreciate that. Thank you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.